The diffusion welding process. Diffusion welding process is basically a type of solid state welding process that relies on the diffusion to create a weld through a combination of heat and pressure. It generally requires long time, as much as around 1 hour at elevated temperatures, and usually it is conducted in a vacuum or protective atmosphere to prevent oxidation at the welding interface. Pressure is applied, and pressure of sufficient magnitude is applied to cause some local deformation at the interface. A machine known as vacuum hot press is often used with this diffusion welding system. So diffusion welding system does not comprise of a very huge amount of deformation, such as observed in friction stir welding, friction inertial welding, etc. But there is some amount of pressure which has been applied between two fraying surfaces. Fraying surfaces are surfaces which are required to be joined together and which are exposed to each other for the weldment. So diffusion welding has good advantages, such as diffusion welding is able to bond dissimilar materials, which are basically difficult to be welded by other processes. So basically, I can produce steel to tungsten, tungsten to niobium, aluminium, magnesium, etc. So different types of dissimilar materials can be welded quite easily by this process, but it is a very lengthy process and the equipment is a bit expensive, and when you require a vacuum, then it becomes a more painstaking process. One of the application of diffusion welding is it is used in aerospace industries, in the manufacturing of composites and electronics industries, nuclear industries, etc. So diffusion welding has very specific applications. So how does the diffusion welding progresses? Basically, what happens is that when two surfaces are basically in close contact to each other, in order to get a very sufficient diffusion strength, what happens is that at aspect, this is basically surface roughness. This is surface roughness, and these small points where there is contact are called asperities. Okay, so what happens is that first initial and asperity contact is created. So you can see asperity contact is created. So in order to get a sufficient diffusion to create a weld, intimate contact between the parts must be achieved. Prior to welding, surface preparation technique that are typically combined metal machining or grinding with chemical etching are required to create very smooth surface and to remove most of the oxides or contaminants. So before doing this diffusion welding, we need to prepare the surface very, very well. Although in other processes also we need to prepare the surface, but for diffusion welding it is utmost necessary because the pressure applied is quite not as high as those in other processes. The application of heat, what happens is that after the asperity contact is established, that what happens is that heat and deformation occurs. So the application of heat reduces the tensile strength. So what happens is that at the asperity contact, the yield strength of the material reduces, and a moderate amount of pressure will create local pressure high enough to plastically deform the asperity peaks and create a required intimate contact. When the weld is complete, then there will be usually minimal evidence of the bond line. So usually what happens is that once the asperities are deformed and the contact is made, a metallic joint is created, diffusion also occurs in between attempts, then what happens is that a pure line is created. Usually there are no pores and the pores are basically gone. So in between the contacts, these pores which were initially present will be gone. So this bond line is basically very minimally evident. Okay, so there are many advantages and disadvantages of this process. Advantages are the minimal degradation of base material is observed, so there are no pores, no porosities, etc. There is no distortion or etc. But the limitation is that it is takes extremely long time, significant surface preparation is required, and does not work well with all materials. So this is basically an example of diffusion welding process. we will see this video. I'm going to put it in Kalam and you can basically observe it later on. But here I want to show you the process, exact process of this diffusion welding. So this is an asperity contact. Okay, once the heat and pressure is applied, then the yield strength is basically overcome and the material deforms, and basically diffusion of atoms happen, new grains are formed, and a pure weld is basically created. This weld is similar to the weld, the strength of this weld is basically similar to that of the base material strength, and it is basically something like there was no welding ever happened. You can see that the bond is so clean, the weld joint is so clean that you will see that okay, there is nothing happened. It was a solid piece of block. Rather than two plates joined together, it will look like that was just a piece of block or something. So you can see these videos later on, and we will move on to the microstructure of diffusion welding. So in this figure has been taken from a research paper. This is the title of the research paper, where they have done diffusion bonding of SS316L. It is a stainless steel and 4J29 cobalt. It is a nickel copper alloy. So, and in between these two materials, steel and nickel copper alloy, they put nickel as an interlayer. So this microstructure, you can see that you have got steel and then you've got nickel copper alloy, and in between they put nickel. And then what they've done is they have applied pressure, they have applied temperature, and they have might have applied a vacuum as well to produce diffusion welding. So this is figure A basically shows the diffusion welding for 180 minutes and figure 2 shows the diffusion welding for 240 minutes. So you can see that the diffusion layer thickness is low for a low time, and the thickness of the diffusion layer increases as the time progresses. In the second picture, figure 5, you can see EPMA, electron probe microanalysis of this weld, and you can see that figure A is basically a scanning electron microscope, and then B, C, D, and E and F are basically individual element EPMA analysis. So here what they want to show in figure B is that nickel has basically diffused into the steel. You can see this variation or transition of color, and this is intermediate between blue and green. So this, if you see at microscopically, what happens is that nickel has basically diffused into the steel. So once the diffusion happens, then a joint is basically created. So this is more or less a little bit for you guys to take interest in research which is being carried out for diffusion welding. We are going to move into the last subtopic of this solid state welding process, which is explosion welding process. In explosion welding process, basically, this process produces a solid state weld through the application of extreme pressures that are created by rapid detonation of an explosive material. So what happens is that between two plates we put an explosive material and then we ignite it. What happens is that a pressure is basically created, and that pressure causes the materials to be joined together. The explosive material is not basically put in between, it is basically put on top of one of the material which has to be explosively welded. So it typically involves welding of two plates, and it is often used to join metallurgically incompatible materials for cladding. The process begins by first preparing the surface, which is very important for all solid state welding process. It is very important for you to first prepare the surface. Then which often require grinding, etching, etc., and then placing one plate on the top of the other, which is something like a lap joint with a very slight gap between them through the use of spacers. Then explosive material is placed on the top plate, which is known as the prime component. The detonation is basically started from the corner of this plate, and the detonation basically starts from corner of the plate and in turn accelerates the prime component down into the base component at extremely high speed on the order of 300 meter per second. So what happens is that you've got two plates and then you put an explosive material on top, and then you've detonated here, and what happens is that there is a spacer plate in between. So what happens is that this detonation causes a pressure to be applied on a top plate, and this top plate basically wants to stick to the base plate. As these two plates collide, extreme pressures are created, which produces a jetting action that provides additional cleaning of the surface to be welded. Important process variable for this process is standoff distance, the collision angle between the prime and base components, and the velocity of detonation. So this is basically a very specialized process, and it has some advantages and disadvantages. The advantages are that extremely low heat input process allows for welding of nearly any dissimilar material combination. So we can basically weld any kind of dissimilar material. It is allows for the creation of relatively inexpensive fabrications that are very resistant to corrosion. So it is basically used in application where we need corrosion resistant applications. It is also limited to non-conductive. It is basically not conductive to a production environment. So basically, you cannot do any this process anywhere, and it requires many steps, including surface preparation prior to welding, flattening, ultrasonic testing after welding, etc. And it is limited in terms of joint design. So this was merely more or less on explosion welding. You can see a video which will be uploaded on Kalam as well. So this was all about the theory of solid state welding process. In the next slide, we are going to work on some numericals of a solid state welding process. This is one more of a research article on the interfacial characterization and performance of copper aluminum conductive heads processed by explosion welding, cold pressure welding, and solid liquid casting. So in this picture, you can see that we are basically comparing the microstructure of explosion welding with cold pressure welding in solid casting joint. You can see that the explosion welding has a vortex created. These are vortex. These are very extreme plastic deformation. And you can see that the amount of mixing or mechanical interlocking is very high in explosion welding. This is not the case in cold pressure welding. But the thing is that in both cold pressure welding and explosion welding, the amount of porosity or inclusion or defects are almost minimal or not visible. But for solid liquid casting joint, you can see that you got porosity here. So there is some mixing, and then there is some porosity observed as well. So this solid liquid casting process is not as suitable, does not seem to be very well suited as compared to cold pressure or explosion welding. And then explosion welding joint is basically more preferable or has more advantage because of the fact that we've got more mechanical interlocking in between aluminium and copper plates. So we will in our next slide, we are going to proceed to one numerical on friction welding, and then this will be the end of our lecture for solid state welding process. Thank you for listening to solid state welding lecture.